In my country, Holland, we are aware that the seawater rise causes problems with salination of our surface water and groundwater, and so we fight against the salt that is not seen as that is seen as a pollution. And but if you go to the Caribbean, there we have those Dutch island of Bonaire, and there in the south we are making salt out of seawater, and there is a 25 hectare site with very high concentration of salt, of course, in that water, and very different type of bacteria and algae grow there, red colored, so you see many different types of colors and around surrounded by this blue sea, very beautiful. And the ground around it is completely salt, so you walk on salt. And when I was visiting that site, then they said, well, this is our natural site, because here we have the most species of birds and animals who live here quiet. No people are allowed to live here. You can't even live there, but animals can. So it's quite a different nature perception from that island and my country. And another example of perception of nature is that as a water board member in 2000, I believe, we had to make a plan for the framework directive, and we have to decide which quality do we like to have that our surface water should have. And you could choose between natural river basins, or you could choose two sewage systems and something in between. And of course, we had the highest ambition, so we choose those natural river basins, and we made a natural plan for that and sent it to Brussels for comments. And then the first comment which came back was, how can you call your country nature? Because if there were no men, there was no Holland. You would be flooded by sea, so you are no nature. That's not possible. And so that was quite a shock for us, because we tried to maintain our natural situation. And well, let's go now to the presentation. But I thought maybe it's good that we also have some smart definitions of all those nature-based solutions. Well, I would like to start my presentation with overview of current situation of urban water management. We have a centralized drinking water plant on the left, which makes drinking water out of groundwater or surface water. Then we have a pipe system to town to supply that to everyone, and we can use this water, and then used water goes to the sewage system together with the rainfall which falls in our city. And all that water goes to a central wastewater treatment plant, also very centralized in the end. And this system suffers a lot of problems. I put here a list of the problems, but especially drinking water. In this summer, when there was a drought, we had not enough groundwater anymore, and we had to deliver more water, because when there is a drought, there is a need for more water, for cooling, for refreshment, for showering. So you see, water demand is rising, and water supply cannot meet that demand. And we are still below our groundwater reserves for the long term. And by climate change, we expect more problems here in future, longer droughts and lower rainfall in summertime. There's also the problem of pollution of this groundwater by industrial and agriculture activities, mainly nutrients, and that all costs a lot of energy and to get all those pollutants out of the water. So that's a second problem of this central systems. Then the sewage system has a problem that due to the climate change, we have more heavy rains. And they also stay longer time on the same place. And normally they went over our country very fast, but we have seen a very high rainfall on a small city for 2 days, only on this small city. And this sewage system can't handle that. So we need to have solutions for the rainfall, as you said in your Barcelona case. We're also looking for that in Holland. And then the wastewater system, that is quite a difficult thing to explain. Wastewater is a mix of non-digested food and some other molecules. It is a mix of almost everything. But to make all those molecules in this wastewater, that has cost a lot of energy. And what we are now doing is we oxidize that in this wastewater plant, and the energy goes to the atmosphere. And that is not wise if you're looking for circular solutions, because you can make very pure water out of wastewater. Oh, sorry, the microphone was not so good. And you can recover energy from this wastewater, and you can, of course, recover nutrients or even these larger molecules for reuse. But it is difficult because in industry, as I will explain later, this is done already for many years because there it's economic because the high concentration of pollutants. But because we mix our urban wastewater with the rainfall, this water is very diluted. And diluted water costs a lot of energy or investment in membranes and other technologies to treat it. So my conclusion is for future urban water situation that we should stop this centralized system. And of course the question is then, what now? And then I have proposed, together with my colleagues in the time at TNO, that we develop a more smart, decentralized systems aiming at specific parts of the city who could be connected. Like industry, and I come back to that later, sport fields. We have now more and more artificial sport fields, which could also be used for the recovery of rainwater. And all these office buildings can be used for recovering of harvesting of their own rainwater. Agriculture and parks, they need nutrients and they can also be used for recovery of water. Hospitals is an issue by itself because hospitals have certain problems with wastewater. The first is they have those bioresistant bacteria which can cause diseases in our surroundings, in our environment. And that's of course not so nice because those buildings are built to make sick people better and not the other way around. And that's what they currently do. And the other issue which is there, and not uniquely there, but it is specific there in high concentration, that is the existence of the so-called endocrine disruptors. In a popular way, it's called medicines. And those medicines and water, the concentration of that in our country, are steeply rising in wastewater, in surface water, and in our drinking water. And we now have a political debate what we are going to do about it. But we are sure we have to imply laws and concentration levels, which are very, very low. But it will be at a high cost to get this all out of the water. And to my opinion, it's not necessary to get out of the water, because if you want to drink drinking water without medicines, take rainwater as a source and you will not have any of those problems. And this will be as an example also later in my presentation. So I will not go in detail of all the aspects of the water grids. In this infographic could be worked out on many other fields, but it's just to show, give you an example of how a whole city could change its water management system and control it on a more decentralized base. To give you an idea, we made a conceptual plan for a diving hotel in Rotterdam. We did that together with the European Space Agency. They have a lot of technologies in development for the reuse of water, also wastewater for reuse. So we thought we will combine all that technological knowledge with this new concept. And this plan is not built. The other plans I will present later are built. But this is just to give you an overview. We made a conceptual design of a hotel with many rooms. And we calculated the water demand. And then we calculated the amount of rain which falls on this area. And of course, that was not enough. And then we made a plan that we use this water first for drinking and for cooking. And then this water could be treated and could be reused for showering and for the toilet, and then the toilets could be separated, could be toilet even without water, because you could collect the urine separately, and that makes it nice, because then you have all those medicines who are there, or natural hormones which are in the water and you want to get rid of them, you have them then at the highest concentration. And that means at the highest concentration, the lowest cost to remove them out of those aqueous solutions. And then the black water could be mixed with the garbage from the kitchen, the restaurants, and you could digest that and make energy out of that, which is also of importance for this hotel, which was not only water autarkic, but also energy autarkic and partly food autarkic. To lower the water demand in buildings for families, we found out that a one-person family in the Netherlands could live off its own rainwater. But if you have a family of three persons, you will not have enough if you have the current water use. And the highest use of water is the shower. In my country, it's 55 liters a person a day. And there are now several developments going on. This is a commercial which you can buy in our country. And this is a very luxury one because it has a very high shower head, which gives you 20 liters a minute water shower, which is very high waterfall, because an environmental friendly one would only be 5 liters a minute, so 4 times higher. But still, this whole shower only used 10 liters for a person a day, because it reused the water and it treated in between. And for that reason, it's not only a water saver, which is of importance if there's water scarcity. But if you look from an economic point, the water saving is 10 euros a person a year, average. But the energy savings can be 70 euros a person a year. And that's, of course, much more interesting, because then you have together 80, and you, when you have 3%, you have 240 euros. And then when you have a shower for 10 years, you have an amount of money. This one is more expensive, but when you take a more average one, but will come later on the market, this is a price that can be done for this type of equipment. So, to go back to nature and look for your own water situation, this is possible. Then I was asked to look at industrial water issues. And I'm leading a working group, Water and Industry, for WSSTP, and there we try to put all the issues we found in one infographic, so it was a lot to take about. We put industry central in the middle, of course, because the focus of our discussion. And it is surrounded by neighbors. We have urban neighbors, nature, which is, of course, an official issue in our country, and agriculture. And when you compare the water need of those four neighbors to each other, there is a remarkable difference. A city more or less uses the same amount of water in our country as the rainfall is on their surface area for all their applications. For nature, it's more or less in equilibria as well. Agriculture has a 15% higher water need to make all those tomatoes and so they need a little bit water coming from the drinking water facilities, which will be groundwater or surface water. But they are obliged to use their rainwater in their area by law. So those three are more or less in equilibria with the natural situation. They only need solution when there is a drought. But when you look to industry and industrial site, we calculated for two of them in my country, an industrial site uses 50 to 100 times more water than falls on their surface area. And then, of course, the question comes where to get it. And as you can see on the left, on the water purification square, there are many, many sources, the same for drinking water, groundwater, surface water. The reuse of urban wastewater is now more and more common. But due to stricter obligations to treat your own wastewater, and I will go from the red line, so around this industrial site, you see more and more reuse of issues in that water. The first is energy itself, the heat content, which is used in for city heating. Myself, my house is heated on such a way. And this heat can, of course, also be used to restart chemical processes. So you can save primary energy there in your process. And you can also transfer heat to power. New technological developments are there going on and now piloted. And then you're left over with, let's call it the blue line, colder wastewater. And this heat is not going anymore to the rivers, which cause problems with oxygen concentration. Who higher water is, who lower the oxygen concentration. And that means that it's more difficult for fish to live there. So you solve also some natural problems in the river by using this heat, reusing this heat in industry. Then when you have this aqueous colder flow, you can recover water with reverse osmosis or membrane distillation. You can recover very pure water for your processes. And at the same time, you're concentrating all your pollutants. And that makes it more economic to treat them and to reuse them in your factory or to digest them anaerobically and make methane out of them and use that in the gas pipe systems. Then you're left over with a aqueous flow, and this aqueous flow contains still inorganic compounds, which of course are not in any case can be digested to gas. There now we see more and more recovery of nutrients, and nutrients are necessary for agriculture. Phosphate is getting scarce. European phosphate use is mainly coming from Morocco. So it's outside Europe, and those fields are getting down, so phosphorus prices are going up. And still we can't do, we do more and more biological agriculture with less nutrients, but then of course you have 2.5 to 3 times less production of food, and if we still want to feed the whole world population, then still we can't stop using nutrients. Else 2/3 of the population wouldn't have food before we have made this whole transition. So nutrients are very important. And then we come to minerals. There are many minerals in water, and one which comes up for recovery now is lithium. Lithium is also scarce, price go up, especially for battery constructions. And more lithium is found in our water, also in ocean water, seawater. You can find up to sometimes 10 ppm. And which is a low concentration, but if you do further concentration for other reasons, because, for instance, recovery of drinking water out of seawater, it also makes sense to recover lithium then. Well, then also you have the same problem within hospitals. Then you end up with a micropollutant. That's the summary of the name. The concentrations are very, very low, but the molecules influence our hormonic system. And so also for industry, it is expected they have to treat this water also to remove those micropollutants before they are going to the river. We have a national debate this year on one industrial site who makes a molecule, which the popular name is Gen X, and it is found in the whole area in the drinking water system. And it's a bit strange, no one knows how it comes there, because the drinking water company doesn't make drinking water out of the surface water. And that's why where the company emissions, it's Gen X, it's not by vaporization, it's only by aqueous flow. But here you can see that they are now obliged. It's the first site obliged to treat those micropollutants. If you have removed them, then you have a water quality which is almost excellent for reuse in your industry. So you will never put that water back to surface water when you reuse it in your factory again. And then the cycle is closed. And then you have three cycles closed. You have the water cycle, you have the nutrient cycle, or the chemical cycle, and the energy cycle, which are three different cycles. This whole story looks simple, and we put their industry as a one type site, but that's not completely true. And other problem of this whole process, which can be done, of course, is that the water value is very low. If you want to buy water as a company, the costs are low. For most companies, the water costs are very less than 1% of total cost making any product. Money is not the problem, but what the problem is that, as I showed you before, is that if there is water scarcity and you cannot get access to that water what falls on agriculture in the city because they need it themselves, then you are in problems. And also by law in my country, the industry is one of the first who goes out after recreation and transport. Industry is first forbidden to take surface water as a source for water before energy production and before drinking water production. That will be the last who will go out if there's no surface water anymore. So for them, the availability of water is a risk. And if you then look to the cost, if there's no water for a day or for a week, the cost will be very, very high. And for that reason, they have a very strong economic incentive to come with long-term solutions. And this could be a solution for the long term. Another problem is technical. Each site have a different quality and flow of water with other composition. You can find any type of pollution in there. And they all need other testing and other techniques to remove it. And so we came up with ideas of more modular and standardized technologies which are already on the shell. So you don't have to design and build a new grid, but you can all connect it very, very fast and test your equipment on a very short term to look which technology, which type of membrane or oxidation technique is best for this solution. So we have to come up with faster solutions and cheaper solutions. Then agriculture. In the area of Rotterdam, we have this abandoned harbor. The harbor is still very large in Rotterdam, but not at the same place. It has abandoned the city completely. And we built new islands on the sea where these very large ships are now coming. And then containers are put on trains, and from there it goes inland. So we have this very large area in the center of town with abandoned harbors and abandoned buildings around it. And the city is looking for many new applications. And one person came up with the idea of building a floating farm. And this is almost ready. It will be opening in 2 or 3 weeks. It has a lot of international interest. It's not only a farm, but this also will make dairy products. It will also have an educational issue for in the city to learn people how to make your food and where it's coming from. And this is seen as a future solution, not only for the Netherlands and empty harbors, but also for the rising sea level. You will have more and more flooded lands where you can build floating systems. And of course, then the interaction with your surrounding should be completely independent so that you don't give environmental problems anymore. So the problems with the manure and the urine are quite complex for the situation. I'm not involved there, but I'm involved for the production of the feed water and for the animals and process water for the dairy equipment, which have to be rinsed each day and oxidized. We do that with technology, which is very simple. We have harvesting of rainwater from the roof via pipe. It goes to the upper tank. And via the upper tank, it flows through a pipe, through a biofilter, and through a membrane to remove bacteria and viruses. If you look to the quality of rainwater and compare to drinking water standards, there are only a very few issues which are above the standards. So it's a very easy treatment without energy, without chemicals. It flows by gravity. And then you have a tank below with a very pure product. And the results are no hormones or medicines, very low nitrate, which in my country a problem because concentrations are roughly 10 ppm in the Netherlands. And recently it was found that nitrate causes cancer already from 3 ppm. So if you want to drink pure water, you can better do it from rainwater than from the drinking water system if you have a problem with nitrate. Then there's no hardness, so that's good for industry. So the industry liked this project very much because that means no corrosion, no maintenance. And it's also nice at home because you don't have to maintain your coffee machine and you don't have to use additional chemicals for your washing machine and your dishwasher. And there are no PAX or pesticides in the water found. Low concentration of bacteria. And there are totally no forbidden bacteria found in this drinking water system for testing now for half a year. And there's ammonia found at ppm levels, but ammonia is not a toxic compound, but a desired food concentration. Now, if you then look to the availability of water, then in my country, I don't know how that's in Ireland, but my country, the rainfall on the blue square area, if you collect the rainfall in that area, you would have the same amount as the total demand for drinking water in our country. And if you look to the amount we are only drinking, that is the red dot, it's only 1% of the surface. So we don't need to use so many roofs to solve all this issue, to use this better quality of water than to use groundwater and surface water. Here I've shown a technology. I don't know if it's wise to go in detail here, but it gives you an indication which components are necessary to transfer the organics into methane in an aqueous solution. You can do that on the classical way as shown here, but there is a new system, anaerobic membrane reactors under development that are very compact system. That's always nice for industries because they have those small sites. And it's a very important part to recover energy from water. So, to summarize my presentations, to my opinion, centralized systems are out. And maybe smart urban water grids, or let's call it more decentralized systems, will be the future. And that will take some time to come there. We need a kind of transfer period. But when there are droughts and additional floodings, each time when those things occur, the sense of urgency come on with board members and politicians to do something about it. So we will see pilot and demonstration of new systems like this water from heaven system, the floating hotel, energy recovering systems, low-cost water treatment system by standardization and modularization, and you will see future new sustainable showers. So I would like to end how to do that, and as a membrane specialist, I always like to use membranes, and there are also now artificial membranes used in our brains. So from there, I think that the most wise way to go further is use your membranes. Thank you very much.